Dr. Megan Coylewright. I'm a cardiovascular physician here, specifically focusing on interventional cardiology, but I'm very passionate about shared decision making. This is an idea of how we can best partner with patients in tough decisions, and specifically involves an approach that I want to share with you today that we're passionate about in research. And I've invited today my patient, Dr. Jim Barrett, to join me. He and I have partnered in decisions together using decision aids to help promote shared decision making, and I'll ask him to share a little bit of our story together so you can hear about what it's like in action and our thoughts about how we might move forward in the future to make this even more effective. So traditionally, when you come to your physician to make a decision together, you may be overwhelmed with a lot of the choices, and some patients even choose to defer to their physicians. But we're finding more and more that it's very important that we talk with our patients about those choices and share with them the risks and benefits so that they can participate. Because really, shared decision making is a meeting of two experts. I'm the expert in the choices available to my patients and their risks and benefits. But Dr. Barrett's an expert in his values and preferences and what's most important to him. And traditionally, we've had a tough time in short, rapid visits being able to elicit patient values and preferences. So here at Dartmouth-Hitchcock, we're looking at how we can use decision aids to help in that process. Now, we've studied decision aids here for about 3 decades. And traditionally, they've been tools that we've given patients to take home, read about their condition, and then come back to the clinic visit. But we've got new innovative strategies of how we can improve upon those methods of partnering with patients. And specifically, we'd like to have tools that we can use during the clinical visit. So we have a decision aid focused specifically on a disease condition called atrial fibrillation. It's an irregular heart rhythm that puts people at increased risk of stroke. And in that condition, people have a choice to take a blood thinner for the rest of their life, to not take a blood thinner, or to have a device implanted in the heart. And each person thinks about this decision in a different way. So our decision aid, which is integrated into the electronic health record, pulls data about Dr. Barrett, so it's a personalized decision, and I can display for him his risk of stroke and bleeding and hear about how he values those different choices. And then we can engage in a dialogue to decide together. Dr. Barrett, I wondered if you could tell a little bit about that choice for you when you were deciding about using a blood thinner or a device to help reduce your risk of stroke.
Yes, I'd be happy to. I didn't like the idea of taking medicines all my life. I'm not a pill taker, and I've not had to take one up until, and that's what I was being told I needed to do to avoid stroke. So I was pleased to hear that was a surgical alternative to medicine, the Watchman procedure. So I was then sent to Dr. Coylewright, and she had a program. I didn't realize it was that individualized to me, but we sat and looked at a computer recording together that basically gave the risk factors for my age, on the med, not on the med, risk of a bleed, which is also important. And I heard that information, and I won't go through the numbers now. My decision was to wait a bit.
Mm-hmm. And we had multiple conversations after that time about this decision, using the tools so that he could understand the differences in the risk and benefit. And it's interesting because sometimes people say, you know, there are patients that don't want to partner in the decision, maybe an older generation that just wants to be told what to do. But I find that what patients don't want to be is abandoned in that decision. They do have values and preferences about what's best for them, and if we can figure out the best way to elicit those, particularly in an efficient way during the clinic visit, I think we can lead to greater outcomes. And so specifically, Dr. Barrett is a patient representative on our large trial that we're looking at to be able to test whether these decision aids lead to improved patient outcomes. Things like patient knowledge, patient satisfaction with the visit, choosing an option for them that matches with their values and preferences, but we're also interested in looking at bigger questions, such as, does the use of a decision aid with a physician actually improve outcomes like stroke? We know that 1 in 3 of folks who have atrial fibrillation and are at high risk for stroke don't take a blood thinner. I mean, they're voting with their choice to not take the medication. So there's a big gap in care that I think that we can address. And we suspect that if we can match the decision with patients' values and preferences, we may be able to lower the risk of stroke. So specifically, I'm looking for people that are interested in partnering with me in this important research. We have patients embedded in this research and other stakeholders such as clinicians, nurses, administrators, researchers, community members, and we think that by bringing all of these people together, we can truly accomplish the goal of reducing stroke. But we need support. shared decision-making trials have not traditionally been those that have been funded by large agencies. There's not money to be made here. There's not necessarily an advocacy group that's behind us, but we feel very passionate about it, especially at Dartmouth-Hitchcock. It's been a focus of ours since we started the first shared decision-making center back in the 1980s. Now we're trying to innovate by embedding decision aids into the electronic health record so that we can help busy clinicians have these conversations with their patients and potentially lead to improved outcomes. So my ask is that we have people partner with us in this research and become community member partners and also funding partners so that we can move forward to understand what are the best practices in how to partner with our patients and lead to better outcomes.
Dr. Coylewright, first of all, that was a beautiful presentation. And the concept is terrific, shared decision making. Who wouldn't want to do that? But is this an area that's already well established? Don't doctors do this already? And if it's not already well established, what exactly are you doing? Are you developing these aids, or are you trying to determine whether these aids actually result in better outcomes for our patients?
That's a great question. Certainly the reason why many of us went into medicine was so that we could take care of people and honor their values and preferences. And as medicine has become more complex and the pace of medicine has increased, what the research suggests is that we're often missing some of those connections that were really at the beginning of medicine where we were able to partner with patients over decades. So there are specific pieces of the shared decision-making process that we see are missing. For example, we're very good at talking about risks and benefits, but we're less skillful at eliciting patient values and preferences. Part of that is because of time, but part of it is because our patient groups are becoming more diverse. Our patients may differ from us in age, gender, race, education levels, roles and priorities, and so it's difficult for us to guess what's most important to patients. So those are some of the things that we can improve on over time. Certainly we all at our heart are working to do that work every day, but we can have tools that improve that process. Now the research that we're doing at Dartmouth-Hitchcock is actually looking at testing the effectiveness of these tools. We take tools that have been developed and we refine them with patient input, for example. So Dr. Barrett has participated with me in focus groups where we've looked at the tool we're studying called Health Decision to see whether it's effectively communicating what we hope it is. And perhaps you could talk a little bit about your experience with the decision aid and some of the modifications that we've talked about.
Sure. That's trying to keep it brief. As I mentioned earlier, you had materials that were specific for various risk factors. We also did get into preferences because, as I said initially, I preferred not to be taking medications for the rest of my life. So all that had a chance to come up in the course of the discussion. Then, as time went by, I saw fit to wait a bit the first time, and then I saw Dr. Coylewright again a year later. And at that point, the risk factors for me have gone up because age is one of the risk factors for getting a stroke from AFib. And without going through all of that conversation, I decided to go ahead and do it then rather than later. And
so we did. I think that's very well said. One of the things that we've learned from Dr. Barrett specifically and other patients is that sometimes the decision needs to be revisited. And for us as clinicians, we were really looking for a decision that day. So there are ways that we can put that into decision aids to prompt patients that we don't have to make a final choice today. And actually, some of our decision aids now have new components where they can take home copies of the decision aids so they can study that on their own. And that comes from our patient focus groups. So we do adapt decision aids, but then we test them in trials to determine their effectiveness for outcomes like improved patient knowledge, satisfaction, the choice made, and now we're really hoping with additional funding that we might be able to study it for outcomes such as stroke.
So I'm curious, question directed to both of you, about how you adjust your approach with the decision aids to specifically address the person's level of knowledge and understanding about their own condition. It's pretty unique because you have a doctor who is your patient. But when you don't have a doctor and you have someone who's really in the dark about what is happening with them, how do the decision aids and your approach change to adapt to the person's level of understanding?
What's so interesting about our relationship as patient and clinician, and that I think is true for many folks that have, you know, high education level, is that when you are a patient, you're much more vulnerable. And you don't always have expertise in that specific area. For example, there was a new device available that he had very little information about. So I think regardless of the education background, right? And so certainly trying to partner with patients to understand what is your baseline knowledge and goals. But one of the studies that we've done leading up to this work is looking at the impact of decision aids on people who have different levels of health literacy. So when we study decision aids and we look at the impact, when you come into the visit with high health literacy, you still increase your knowledge. But when you come into the visit with low health literacy, it's a much bigger jump, reducing the disparities between the two groups. So we see that they're effective across a broad range, but that's not by accident. When decision aids go through a very careful user-centered design process, they're designed with patients who have different levels of education so that we can make sure that it reaches different people.
And if I could comment, although the doctor part obviously made it easier to understand some things, I didn't know much of anything about the condition we were talking about. So I look back on those sessions, it was more getting information. I may have been able to ask different questions because of some medical background, but not really. I wanted to know what the risks were, basically. And that's what the learning devices were very helpful with.
So this shared decision-making process sounds like it's wonderful for the individual patient, and you clearly have benefited from it, Dr. Barrett. But thinking forward, atrial fibrillation, for example, affects millions of people across the United States, and the risk for things like stroke from atrial fibrillation or bleeding from being treated with an anticoagulant drug are quite real. Is there a potential for your research to make an impact on outcomes really across the country?
We are very hopeful for that. And certainly, I try to generate hypotheses about whether we can do that and then test it before we make major investments across the country. So what we're doing right now is running a randomized trial of the decision aid for atrial fibrillation and stroke prevention here at Dartmouth-Hitchcock on a very small scale, funded by our cardiovascular section. And we're looking to make sure that we see that there are some early signals of improved patient outcomes with use of the decision aid compared to usual care. And we're looking specifically at outcomes like patient knowledge and intent to take the medication. But we need a lot bigger trial to be able to answer that question about whether we will be able to affect outcomes. We, for example, are very passionate about testing the decision aid amongst most more diverse populations, including race and language, for example. So in order to do that, we need to have a bit more support so that we can test it broadly. And then we'll be able to answer that question about whether we'll be able to disseminate and implement a tool like this to really reduce the risk of stroke across the country.
Thank you very much. We really appreciate the time that you've spent with us today. Enjoyed hearing very much about your project, your program, and we're very excited to help you get the word out about what wonderful project this is.
Thank you for the opportunity. We're grateful to share our story. Sure.